So here we are again at Prismic Studio, and today I'm with Sarah from Algolia. And I thought that the journey that you had through JavaScript is interesting, maybe for some of our users and audience. Basically, there are people that use Prismic. They come from different backgrounds. Some of them come from PHP, but now that JavaScript is becoming this language that you can use in the server side, and on the client side, and it's getting it's developing a lot. We thought that maybe your journey is similar to somewhat of the journeys of some users that will be using Prismic. So I want first to ask you, did you always do engineering and programming in your career? What did you start with?
So I've got quite a long journey into engineering. I started programming. The first programs that I wrote, I was probably 15 and I was just playing around. It was not even a career back then. It was it's almost 15 years ago. So
what did you start with?
Sorry?
What did you start with?
I started with 15. HTML, CSS play, and I was not even coding. I had Microsoft front page on my parents' computer. And I was just playing with the WYSIWYG editor and realizing, oh, there's something generated behind. And back then, it was not really a career. And I remember that was the time when Flash was a really hot technology. Everybody wanted to do Flash websites. And one of my first websites was a Flash website. After that, I learned a lot.
You're really making me feel very old. Yeah. I started with Quick Basic and HTML wasn't a thing back then because internet wasn't a thing back then. So yeah, I feel my age here. But you said it's back when Flash was popular then.
Yes, and it was. And you could actually write some action script, which is kind of...
I did a lot of that.
Yeah. Well, I did some and I learned AS2, AS3. Now that knowledge is not really... not really interesting anymore, but...
It was ECMA though, right?
Yeah, it's ECMA. So it's kind of similar to JavaScript. But then what happened is that I followed another direction. I did 1 year of journalism. So I was not at all going into engineering. And I realized after a year that it was not really the path for me. So I decided to
journalism,
go back.
That is.
Yes. I decided to go back to what I loved. And so that's when I decided to go back to engineering.
Can I ask you, how old were you when you switched back to programming?
I was probably 18 or 19.
Right.
And
okay.
So, yeah. And so I went to, I decided to apply for a company. Of course, I had no practical professional experience, but they took a shot. They took a chance with me and I was going part school, part work.
Oh, you did that.
Yeah, okay. It was a 1 year thing. And then, so it was in an agency and decided, to give me a shot. And that's when I started professionally. I did some PHP at first. That was my very first language that I did professionally.
I'll get back to PHP because, there are some things to dig into there. But, ActionScript, I guess back in the time, it felt magical because you couldn't do much with HTML on the web. And, you could do anything with Flash, right? With ActionScript.
That was...
Animations, a lot of other things with ActionScript. It felt like almost magic, right?
It was actually magic, and that was what was, I think, appealing for many people and for me, especially when you did not have really a computer science background, is that you wanted to do something that you can see and feel, like you imagine the end product that you wanted to make. And doing something with HTML and CSS and assembling all those parts together was not that trivial. But with Flash, you had a program, like a professional program that back then it was Macromedia, then it became Adobe. But you had an actual program that you could use, and it looked like kind of a video program, like you could edit frame by frame, you could design in it, and then you had some kind of an executable. It's not exactly an executable, but it was a file format that you could embed in a web page, and everything was working.
That was great because maybe it made the whole learning curve much easier because you start by frame by frame, and you say okay, but I want to do that, and I don't want to do all the frames. How can I do? And then you start doing programmatically. And slowly you get into scripting instead of doing frame by frame. That's at least what I felt. that it allowed me to go into that world, but you know, in a kind of smooth learning curve.
Yes, it was really the same experience for me, and I really thought creatively back then because I wanted something that looked good and I wanted to have animation, and the web was like a lot less codified as it is today. And so, like, if you remember like internet 15 years ago, it was wild. Like, the designs from one website to another were totally wild, and you had a lot less technologies, but everyone was doing really crazy stuff.
Yeah, I remember.
And everyone wanted to do something that looked cool and looked like a cinematic experience.
Yeah.
So that's why I decided to do Flash. It was fun. It was cool to learn.
And the web UX wasn't exactly defined. So
yes,
there were not rules, don't do this, do this. So Flash gave you this kind of canvas of doing
yes,
whatever you want. And then this point where Apple decided that Safari should not support Flash. And I was like, why? Like, Flash is good and all. But I guess that was good for the web because, you know, suddenly CSS was like, more companies were investing more into CSS and JavaScript, and that allowed the web to develop much more quickly than before.
Yes, and it was exactly when HTML5 really started to become something.
Right.
And you had standards, and we started to take, like, there were many things happening at the same time. We started having mobile devices, and so we thought, okay, responsive design should be something. It's important that a website looks good on a tablet, on a desktop, but also on a phone. And it's important to have something that a search engine can read, and also something that assistive technology can read, which is really hard to do with Flash.
With Flash, right?
You have to
it's
go
camera,
through
right?
hacks. It's really complex. And also, it started to be, okay, we have computers with broadband connection, but then we have now 3G, or we have like a mobile connection, and a Flash FLV, an FLV file is really heavy.
Yeah.
So
and you have to wait until it downloads all of it, until
yes,
you start experiencing anything.
Absolutely. Like, this is an embedded experience. This is a closed, compiled piece of software, piece of engineering, while with CSS, HTML, JavaScript, everything can be loading at a different pace and you can start showing something. So it was
like
really
to interrupt, but the thing you said, it was a closed experience.
Yes.
And to compare it, where you should not compare it to one page, it's as if the whole website had to load. You had to download the whole website to see one page. That
yes,
was Flash, right? You couldn't load one page and then the other page. You had to load the whole app and then start browsing through it. That was a Flash experience.
Yes,
yeah,
absolutely. And it's really a different time. And back then, yeah, we had preloaders because, of course, we could show how much time it was going to take. But it was really a different experience. Today, now, we are used to having immediate experiences. We want like when we go to a website, we want it to load instantly. We are told that if a website takes more than 8 seconds, and it's probably even less now, that people are going to leave. It's because people are expecting,
I guess, 2 seconds or something.
Yeah,
is now.
It's probably something closer than that. I remember the 8 seconds, and now it feels endless. But back then,
8 seconds.
Yeah,
I
remember when I was a kid, like, just turning on my computer took like probably a couple of minutes.
Right.
Because it was an old Windows computer.
And no SSDs and all of that.
Yes, exactly.
So I will go back to PHP now.
Yes.
Right. So then you said, like, okay, I'm going to start PHP. Why did you start PHP exactly?
Okay, so because back then PHP was really the popular language. Like, if you wanted to do some dynamic websites, PHP was the way to go. It was. So we are in 2008, something like that. And really, PHP is the most popular language to do web. And so the company that I applied for, they did PHP. They did a lot of PHP. So I decided, okay, I'll give PHP a shot and I will learn how it works. I already had some basics in HTML and CSS. And then I was like, okay, I need to learn some real language, at least being able to do some computing. And so that's when I started PHP.
Okay. So, but you know what? It's wonderful how, like, things change over time. You know, back then, like, at some point, PHP was the language, the technology. And that after that, it was the language that you should not be using, because PHP, you know, everyone was saying, ah, PHP sucks and all of that. And then PHP gained back some force. And now there are frameworks that are trying to copy some of the experience of PHP.
Yes.
Like Next and Nuxt, they're trying to reproduce some of their properties of PHP in how you deal with pages, routing, and, you know, all these kind of serverless, all these things.
Yeah, just-in-time compilation.
Yeah, all these kind of things. So so PHP actually had a huge effect on the web. You know, we always talk about JavaScript shaping the web, but I guess PHP had its part on shaping the web in a way.
Yeah, I think so too. And I feel like most languages like come and go. So you have technologies like Flash that is probably never coming back, or maybe it's coming back in another form. But languages like PHP, or any languages for that matter, I feel that they come and go because you have new things, like new waves. But like, I think the engineering world is like any other area. You have stuff that are hot at a certain moment, and then they go out of style because something comes and replaces it. And then they come back for many reasons. So at the end of the day, I feel like all the debates about languages, technologies, most of them make little sense as long as you can solve a problem with them. And as long as you understand where their strengths are and where their weaknesses are, why you should be using it for something and why you should not be using it for something.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So it's not... And often, you know, programming languages, they inspire from each other. Even sometimes they don't admit it, but, you know, often the basics of, you know, paradigms and all of that are very small. You know, languages inspiring from the others. So you told me then that you moved from PHP to JavaScript.
Yes. So what happened is that, so back then, there was no really a distinction between backend and frontend. You did not really specialize into one or the other. But I started discovering that I was really into, like, I really like design. I'm not a designer, but I really like design. I really like to turn a design into a nice interface that you can use, that looks great, that is easy to use. And I started realizing, okay, if you really want to do front-end or UI well, you have to really dive into it because it has so many things to it. It's not just one thing that you can dabble in. You really have to go all in. And so that's when I started really looking into the technologies that make a front-end, that make a UI. And so I already knew HTML and CSS. I needed to perfect that, but I also realized, oh, there's a language, there is a scripting language that runs in the browser that does not necessarily need a server to run, like it was with PHP. And you can do a lot of things in the client, and oh, that's nice, like it's instant, and it's already available, and you can do some reactive UIs. And so that's when I started doing JavaScript. And so I'm saying JavaScript, but back then it was really jQuery. Like many people, right. My very first steps into JavaScript were doing jQuery, which was extremely popular back then.
And it was an important part of also evolving JavaScript. You know,
yes.
This kind of a querying part into the DOM and finding a DOM element and doing something about it was like a big thing, right?
Yes.
And that would allowed a lot of frameworks to exist and then to say like, okay, maybe if we should make some of this native so that we improve performance. But it came, so jQuery also had a big effect on web development, I think.
Yes, I think jQuery was a really big stepping stone in the evolution of JavaScript and what made JavaScript what it is today and the prevalent place that it has today. Because back then, doing something, a website that worked cross-platform, like working on IE6 was still something that you had to develop for. IE7, then you had Firefox, Chrome. I don't think Chrome was already there, but to do something cross-platform took an enormous amount of effort because the standards were not respected from one platform to another. jQuery made it painless. Everything was working the same way. You did not have to think about it. The experience was awesome. And back then, we were not really thinking of mobile devices and, oh, maybe we should not send so many bytes to the end user. So it was okay to have a library that waited probably close to 100 kilobytes. So yeah, jQuery was really important. And then, of course, now it's getting less and less relevant.
People are shy of saying that they use jQuery for good reasons, of course, because now you can do things more like in a more, let's say, modular way without going like imperatively going into the DOM and changing things like on the fly. But, you know, it helped doing a lot of websites and applications that wouldn't have been feasible otherwise, right?
Yes, and I think it's also really helpful for beginners because, like, the native APIs in JavaScript, in many languages, but in JavaScript, are really tough. Like, the developer experience of the native APIs.
It's a bit raw, right?
Yeah, it's really raw, and it's always been raw, and it's probably always going to be raw because it has to be as generic as possible.
And as small as possible,
yes,
probably, right?
Yes, absolutely. And, like, basically, you have to be explicit in all the things that you want to do. Like, if you think of the API to do drag and drop, that's a nightmare. And so when you have an abstraction on top of that, that helps you do it in a much more expressive way.
So can you give us an example to show us that contrast, that difference between, for instance, something that's native and something that you can do in jQuery?
Let me think. Well, for example, when you want to query a piece of the DOM, like when you want to get the parent or when you want to say something like parent until, like I want to fetch the parent until I get to that that selector.
Mm-hmm.
That's really much harder to do with the DOM API. You have to implement a lot of the logic yourself, and it muddies your code, and it makes it a lot less understandable. So you will hide it into an abstraction, and suddenly your code starts looking a lot like jQuery.
It's like more declarative, right?
jQuery is a lot more declarative. And today, when you're using React or Vue, you don't need it anyway because you're not really querying the DOM. So that's not something that you need. But if that's not for you, or if this is not something that requires, like if your project does not require the horsepower of Vue or React, then you have to go with something where you query the DOM yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I get the attractiveness of something like jQuery, even though it has a lot of trade-offs, and you have a lot of other abstractions that you can use, like different, like you have one that is called Zepto. You have many new things.
Well, you're talking about the general way of like seeing the DOM as something you can query and then interact with,
absolutely,
instead of a framework that you know, help you build apps. It's a different vision of things, and you're saying like sometimes for simple things, maybe it makes sense to have, you know, a jQuery style library.
Yes, and I definitely think that it's important to understand what is happening behind the scenes when you're using the DOM API. You realize what you're doing and what is having a heavy impact, like what is maybe performance heavy, and it's important to understand it. But at the same time, not everybody who creates website today wants to become a software engineer, a front-end engineer. Like, some people just want to make a website. They want to do it one shot, and they don't really want to dive into that whole world of front-end. So I think it's also important to have tools for everybody and have tools that everybody can feel comfortable with.
Right, right. So maybe we can dive more into you know, other aspects of this experience. Maybe one of them is also, I know you've been interested in functional programming. Maybe that's something we can touch on in a different video.
Okay. My experience in functional programming is really scoped to JavaScript. Like, I don't really have experience with Haskell or Scala, so I'm not.
But that, I mean, in JavaScript. So especially in JavaScript. Yeah,
okay.
Or other, you know, other things that we talked about.
Sure.
Cool.